What is atrial fibrillation? What are the symptoms and how do we treat it? This and more in this video. Have fun and enjoy. The heart has four chambers: right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, and left ventricle. Normally, impulses leading to ventricle contraction originates from the sinus node. The impulses at first stimulates atria, then it's conducted through the atrioventricular node to the ventricles. The atrioventricular node makes some physiological delay. Such impulse promotes coordinate atrial contraction. In the case of atrial fibrillation, impulses originate not from the sinus node, but from different parts of the atria. The impulses are very frequent. Atrial fibrillation describes when muscle fibers of the atria contract at different times. In such case, atria don't contract coordinately, they twitch, quiver, or fibrillate. There is no effective atrial contraction, but there are only many uncoordinated muscle fiber contractions. Normally, the atria ejects small amount of blood into the ventricles, which is called the atrial kick. In the case of atrial fibrillation, ventricles lose this amount of blood. Risk factors of atrial fibrillation involves valvular heart disease, hypertension, coronary artery disease, previous myocardial infarction, underlying heart failure, obesity, diabetes mellitus, thyroid dysfunction, smoking, alcohol consumption, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, obstructive sleep apnea, sport, genetic factors, and other. But age is the main risk factor for atrial fibrillation. People aged over 80 have atrial fibrillation 9 times more often than people under the age of 60. It's important that atrial fibrillation can be triggered not by only hyperthyroidism, but also by hypothyroidism. Direct pathological alterations include interstitial fibrosis, inflammatory and fatty infiltration, amyloid deposition, microvascular changes, ion channel alteration, sympathetic hyperinnervation, myocyte hypertrophy, apoptosis, and necrosis of myocytes. These alterations lead to tissue heterogeneity and enhanced propensity to ectopy. Tissue heterogeneity means that atrial cells have different electrical properties, including different refractory periods. Micro-reentry develops in atria. It means that impulse cannot be conducted by some fiber because its myocytes are in refractory period. So impulse excites the atrial cells in which refractory periods last, and then it spreads to cells which were in refractory period. This condition leads to re-entry loop. Also, specific area originating very frequent electric impulses in atria may initiate the atrial fibrillation. The most often such area or re-entry loop is located in the left atrium where pulmonary veins enter. Patients may complain of shortness of breath, palpitations, feeling of irregular heartbeats, general fatigue, dizziness. Some patients feel chest pain, but some patients with atrial fibrillation are completely asymptomatic. There is modified European Heart Rate Association Symptom Scale, also called EHRA. EHRA 1 means that the patient is asymptomatic. If patient's normal daily activity is not affected by symptoms related to the atrial fibrillation, then there is EHRA 2, which is subdivided into 2A and 2B. The difference between them is in the fact whether the patient is troubled by symptoms. EHRA 3 means that the patient's normal daily activity is limited. If the patient is disabled and usual daily activity is impossible because of symptoms related to atrial fibrillation, doctor should note EHRA 4. There are 5 types of atrial fibrillation: first diagnosed, paroxysmal, persistent, long-standing persistent, permanent. The first diagnosed atrial fibrillation is considered if it has not been diagnosed before. Paroxysmal type continues up to 7 days. It can be either self-terminating or cardioverted. Persistent atrial fibrillation continues longer than 7 days. When atrial fibrillation lasts for more than 1 year and the doctor decides to restore sinus rhythm, such atrial fibrillation is considered to be long-standing persistent. When it lasts more than 1 year and rhythm control strategy is not accepted, such atrial fibrillation is permanent. Diagnosis of atrial fibrillation is based on ECG. there is no obvious P wave, which normally responds atrial depolarization,
but you can see small phi waves
of different amplitude and duration. Ventricular complexes are irregular and often frequent. Heart rate exceeds 100 beats per minute. Often paroxysmal atrial fibrillation cannot be found during routine ECG because it may self-determinate before record. In such case, devices for long-term ECG registration, for example Holter ECG or loop recorders, are helpful. In patients with implanted recording devices and implanted cardioverter defibrillators with ability of ECG recording, the possibility to detect atrial fibrillation is much more than with the help of Holter ECG or loop recorders. In some patients, atrial high rate episodes can be diagnosed. Atrial high rate episodes mean episodes with heart rate of 180 beats per minute and more for at least 5 minutes in asymptomatic patients. Also, all ventricular complexes should be of supraventricular origin. Often atrial fibrillation can be detected in patients with atrial high rate episodes during long-term monitoring. Transthoracic echocardiography usually reveals increase in left atrial volume. The possibility of atrial fibrillation and frequency of paroxysms is well correlated with the left atrial size. Also, transmitral blood flow changes in the case of atrial fibrillation. What is that? So left atrium and left ventricle are separated by mitral valve. Blood is transferred to the left ventricle in two steps: early left ventricular filling during ventricular relaxation and late ventricular filling during atrial contraction, also called atrial kick. Atrial contractions are responsible for only 15 to 25% of general left ventricular filling. Ratio between peak blood flow during early ventricular filling and during atrial contraction is called E:A ratio. Transmitral flow is M-shaped. In the case of atrial fibrillation, often blood clots develop, usually in atrial appendages. They can be dislodged and transferred with blood flow to cerebral vessels, causing ischemic stroke. For stroke risk assessment, the CHA2DS2-VASc score is used. Also, atrial fibrillation increases mortality, promotes left ventricular dysfunction, impairs quality of life, increases hospitalization rate, causes cognitive decline, and promotes vascular dementia. Management of atrial fibrillation involves 5 tasks: acute rate and rhythm control, assessment of stroke risk and stroke prevention, rhythm control or long-term heart rate control, management of precipitating factors, symptoms reduction. If stroke risk according to CHA2DS2-VASc score is high, oral anticoagulation should be started. It's performed with either vitamin K antagonist, also called VKA, or non-vitamin K antagonist oral anticoagulants, also called NOAC. VKA involves, for example, warfarin and phenoprocomone. These are the cheapest drugs for stroke prevention in atrial fibrillation, but patients should control international normalized ratio, also called INR. Its target value should range from 2 to 3 if there are no special considerations. VKA is preferred in the case of moderate to severe mitral stenosis and mechanical heart valves. NOACs include dabigatran, apixaban, rivaroxaban, and endoxaban. The first of them is direct thrombine inhibitor, others belong to direct 10A inhibitors. NOAC are more expensive than VKA, but they cause major bleeding less often and patients don't need to control INR. Rhythm control may be achieved with either electric cardioversion or pharmacological cardioversion. In the case of moderate and severe heart failure, significant aortic stenosis and left ventricular hypertrophy, coronary artery disease, amiodarone should be used. If there is no relevant structural heart disease, flecainide, propafenone, ibutilide, and varenicline may be used. Also, pill-in-the-pocket approach with propafenone and flecainide is acceptable. It involves administration of antiarrhythmic drugs in a large dose in the onset of paroxysm. Sinus rhythm maintaining may be achieved by amiodarone, dronedarone, flecainide, sotalol, or propafenone. Amiodarone is the most effective antiarrhythmic drug, but it has many extracardiac toxic effects. Beta blockers, digoxin, verapamil, and diltiazem are used for long-term heart rate control. Verapamil and diltiazem are contraindicated for patients with reduced ejection fraction, combination of beta blockers and verapamil diltiazem should be avoided. In the case of unstable hemodynamic, the electrocardioversion is performed. Radiofrequency catheter ablation is a good alternative for pharmacological maintaining of sinus rhythm. Certain areas of atrial tissue are destroyed. Also, atrioventricular node ablation with following cardiac
pacing
is rarely used. In the case of open heart surgery, the MACE procedure may be performed. It's based on creation of labyrinth of passages through which the sinus node impulse finds a route to the atrioventricular node. Surgical left atrial appendage exclusion prevents blood clot formation and reduces risk of stroke.
Thanks for watching this video. Please comment, subscribe, and hit the like button.